we made an album that belonged to us and an album that we enjoyed making.
We really made the album together.
For a lot of albums, for a lot of people, people come in and do it separately.
But we were really in the mix together, weren't we?
Well done. Is that running?
On this particular tour, we were really close. We were five mates from out of Islington that were conquering the world.
Looking back on it, that was our best tour ever. That's Spandau in their pomp.
It's a great piece of footage to find. I'm a man in chains. These are great memories. I don't think I've ever seen this stuff.
Gary, how did you get asked to produce this album? I've forgotten.
Well, I think it's you guys approached me around about 85, wasn't it?
I had some demos and they sounded great. And it was really on the back of that that I said yes, and the fact that I'd done some work with you before on the previous the first two albums. And then it was after the Parade tour, wasn't it, that...
We went to Live in Ireland to work on some new material, to write the album. And then it was really a process of me coming up with songs and then phoning the boys and saying, or waking John up, basically, and saying, there's a song, do you want to hear it? Usually, you heard everything first, didn't you?
Yeah, they woke me up with new songs every day. And we rehearsed in Dunleary, and it was so cold in there that Martin, your bruv, decided he weren't going to do it unless he had a heater. So we had a Caligas heater set up by Martin playing bass just to keep him warm.
For me, it was just it was an adult step to me in writing and moving forward. When I heard the demos, I think my first impression was that you'd grown up.
Well, the other thing is that it's more of a rock album at times. I mean, Cross the Line, it opens with, you know, but although we sort of bookend the album with Through the Barricades, but Cross the Line is the sort of opener, and it's much more, it's arena rock for Spandau. And I think maybe that's got something to do with who we were hanging out with in Dublin.
Def Leppard.
They're still there. They never left. Somewhere in all of that, we did fly back to do Live Aid. You found a load of stuff.
Had a bag of tapes, and literally on the tape would be Live Aid. My God, never having seen these tapes before.
Hey mate, how are you?
Mate.
You all right?
Yeah, good.
Good. When I look back at the band touring in the 80s, this is the tour that I remember. Oh, it's good times. It's great seeing this again. So this is Steve Norman's camera taking this, right? It's every kid's ambition in a band to fly into your gig in a helicopter. And what was weird about this was that Noel Edmonds was flying the helicopter. So it was just bizarre. My biggest memory of this whole day is one of my happiest moments in Spandau Ballet, and that's us on the side of the stage watching Status Quo soundcheck. You know, all the arguments that were to come with each other and the falling out and everything are completely surpassed by this moment for me.
Gentlemen, welcome.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us. It's going to feel a little bit apprehensive out there with 1.5 billion people, or even more now that China's looking
at it. 2 billion. It's 50% of the world's population.
How do you prepare for something like this? How do you get yourselves ready?
I think the adrenaline's going to be pumping so fast tomorrow. I think it's going to be difficult to... people are going to be dragged off. They want to stay on all night.
Bob, have you any instructions for them, just in case by the time you get back to Wembley, they've made some excuse and left?
Well, I hope they change their clothes. Look at them.
What are they? We knew we were going to be on the Terry Wogan I'll be back down
in half an hour anyway. So we'll see you then.
Well, thank you for joining us and taking time off from rehearsal, and good luck tomorrow.
Thank you,
Spandau Ballet.
Walking on stage was great because the sun was out, we were in Wembley Stadium. I'd never seen this many people in one place to go and see a gig, you know. I'd never seen it personally. And it was an amazing moment.
It was a special, special day. And, you know, and it goes in a flash. And stupidly, stupidly wore a double thickness leather coat. I had to be also cool. And, you know, and there I was sweating buckets. Oh. But I remember at one point, as I swung round, the microphone flew out my hand. Literally, but the microphone flew out my hand. I thought, you prat, Hadley, you know. But despite that, it was still a very, very, very special day.
We went to Munich. Why did we go to Munich?
Well, no, we went on a recce first. Don't you remember? We spent about two days travelling around all the studios in Europe.
And we'd done Parade there.
We'd done Parade there. Yeah.
It was familiar territory.
But Munich was special, wasn't it? There's some great records that come out of there.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it was Giorgio Moroder's studio.
And it was basically a bunker, wasn't it, really? It was right. Yeah. It was below ground, tiny, in an estate.
It was at the bottom of a hotel.
So we never saw the light of day, did we?
We stayed every day, and we did the single, Fight For Ourselves.
Yeah. That's right, before anything else.
And we spent, I think, a week there.
We are, we're in the Music Lane studio.
Play the Bitches Back or something. Go on. Bitches Back.
See, this is me just wandering around in the studio, making out and working. I used to come into any studio session, and because I played bass, you know, you put the bass down pretty early on in any recording session. Drums go down, the bass goes down, and that's me, really, done and dusted.
We had a lot of good fun. I think the band, actually, during that period, was probably... We felt the most confident as a machine, as a, you know...
It was a good working unit,
You had grown up, you'd really gelled and come together, and it was one big unit.
The Parade album sort of established who we were as musicians, and I think we wanted to push it one stage further on this album. And also, socially, we were getting on really well, weren't we, going out a lot and enjoying it all.
Indeed. I mean, there were times where we went out and we didn't discuss what we'd done during the day at all. Other times...
Just going to have a fight at P1.
Yeah. Someone might come up with a good idea, and we put that into practice. And that togetherness was very important, I thought.
We really made the album together, and there was a lot of bonding. And, you know, because there are maybe on the next album there comes a time, and maybe there, for a lot of albums, for a lot of people, people come in and do it separately.
Yeah.
You know, guitarist turns up and has his go. But we were really in the mix together, weren't we?
I'm out with a click. I'm just out with a clip. Sorry. Oh, fuck.
I remember this moment when Gary's struggling here. And I remember that really well. And I'm in the studio at this point. Gary is a real perfectionist, no matter what he does in life. He gets really frustrated with himself if it's not going right. And I remember I felt really sorry for him because I knew he could do it backwards. I knew he could play that part. But I'd seen him play it a million times. But to actually put it down and record it, every note being in time and exact, you know, in those days, you never had something that would put those notes in time for you like you do now.
Well done. Is that running? Yeah. You recorded all those disasters, did you?
Yeah.
How am I going to tell people I did it in one? How was it, anyway?
It was good. Very good.
That means that. Okay.
Try and practice a bit more mic technique, yeah?
Yeah.
Try and come in on the mic at the end of the... chorus, you know?
You get kind of groovy on that. The feeling that I have is losing. You know, with bada 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 accents on those bits.
Why did we go to Miraville? Why did we go to Miraville?
We had the opportunity to go somewhere else to mix it. We'd recorded it in one place, which is great. So we'd got all the, if you like, the chemistry and if you like the energy and everything from that place. And now we wanted to go somewhere
warm as well.
Yours, not mine.
I mean, Miraville was gorgeous. It had its own vineyard.
It had its own vineyard, and they threw the wine in. So our sort of worked it out that more wine we drank, the cheaper the album would come in.
That's one way of looking at it.
I remember the mixing going on at that time, and all of us being really, really buzzed about the whole record. I mean, I think
it just had a great feel about it the whole time we were working on it. As far as I was concerned, it was.
And it was not until the mix that we then thought, you know what would be a great idea is if we took an element, a sort of cinematic element of Barricades, and had that at the beginning as an intro.
Like a little overture.
Yeah, like a little overture. And we had, and I remember we decided to have a footsteps.
Yeah, that's right.
Very sort of Floyd.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who was that? Was that Tony? Yeah, couldn't get his footsteps right, could he? Probably. Yeah. In time.
More.
This is amazing for me because there's not very often that we're in a studio all singing down the same mic. And it's quite a nice moment because you're not just sharing the song, you're sharing each other's breath almost at this point, you know.
This is the Chateau, and that's owned by Jacques Lussier, the famous jazz pianist. And the boys sort of all live all around this village.
Other dorms, it's like me and Steve in Delta House.
Don't you get fed up here? It must be very quiet. How long have you been here?
It is a bit of a change. I mean, I don't think I've spent the whole album's worth here.
So it's 18 months since you last released a single, and now here you are tucked away in this remote part of the south of France. What have you been doing in between?
Making an album, really. That's been about it. We spent back half of last year in Ireland writing and rehearsing for the album. Since January, we've been in Munich and then on to here.
But we decided after 5 years of constantly keeping the ball rolling that we would take a little rest. Not that we were tired, but we just felt that the music business as a whole needed a rest from us and us from them. And it would be an opportunity for us to sort of look objectively at the whole thing. As John was saying, this whole album's rehearsed to its fullest live in Ireland. And we decided to use a new producer, Gary Langan. We felt he was more gutsy and he would actually record us as we were. There was always a big difference in Spandau between the sound of the record and the way we sounded live.
People always just say, God, it sounds really good live. Yeah, why does it sound like that on record? So it's been nice to actually put it down on tape.
I loved Miraval. I loved it. This is a lovely memory. This is us being really close and looking at us there where the band was completely together. We were all best friends there. And that's such a nice memory.
We'd have these wonderful lunches on the patio, and the woman who cooked them was Sylvie, and she was a lovely woman, a little bit eccentric, a young lass. And there we were, lunchtime, and all the wine had come out. Did we get anything done in the afternoon? Not a lot. So many people in there, so many problems.
They're in the pretty city lights where we floated our way. The line is here before us, in a body hard to see. I think the stuff produced well in the 80s still sounds the most modern sounding production ever. There's such a leap between the 70s and then what suddenly happened in the 80s in sound quality.
Up until then, the beginning of the 80s, there was no sort of automation, there was no digital, there were no drum machines, there was nothing. And all this started to come along in the beginning of the 80s. And these elements started to put a big influence on the music. It was a great moment. There was a big shift going on, and we were
two camps, weren't we?
Yeah, we were part of it. It was the old school of this whole idea of everybody playing together in the studio, to this whole new way of everybody being separate and being isolated.
We'd learned to play these songs together in Ireland, right? We'd played them all as one. Then we would dissect them and play our separate parts, you know, which gave us, hopefully, the best of both worlds.
Hello!
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 We're Spandau Ballet.
Spandau
Ballet. No, we're not.
Oh, this is a cold day. We're in Covent Garden, which is sort of centre of London, and used to be the famous fruit market.
I don't think I've ever seen this stuff. In those days, shooting those little music videos, they were like shooting films. You know, they were treated like you shoot a film. Nowadays, someone makes a music video and it's kind of 10,000 quid all in one day and it's all over. But when we were shooting these things, Fight For Ourselves or any of them, all those music videos, they were like proper films.
Have you seen set?
No, it's good.
Is it?
They've got all the chairs around and everything, and then right at the back, they've got the toilets.
John is at the moment setting his drums up. Hi, John. And below me is, in fact, a toilet seat.
I don't know why we didn't use a real toilet, actually. It would have been, probably, it's probably been too cheap. For some reason, we had to build them here at enormous expense.
It's true, actually, yeah. We needed larger loos to get cameras in and things.
These toilets, ladies and gentlemen, are so good that someone has actually used one of them.
People never used to film stuff like this, where behind the scenes of a music video. Why we shot this, I'm not quite sure. But obviously, Steve Dagger had the foresight of doing it. So it was, it's lucky we've got it now.
Part of this video is shot against a blue background, which is a special effect, and it allows the director to put anything in the background that he wants.
The hips.
You're gonna have to stand still.
Yeah. Okay, now push your hips against her, Tony. Okay, and then when you pull away, lean back first there, and then there, yeah, like that.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right. But wind it back a bit. Wind it back a bit. And that's Stacey Young, Paul Young's wife. And obviously we've got Sadie. Sadie with the big 80s hair, who became my brother's wife. And these were all kids that, you know, we put out a call on Capital Radio and across the fan clubs for anybody who wanted to come down and join in on the video, on the day, on the shoots.
This, you can imagine, is a break during the making of our video, Fight For Ourselves. So we're just cleaning a little bit of time while the others have dinner.
But most of the time on these videos, what I remember is Steve keeping everyone amused, because that's what he used to do. He was a constant show, Steve, and a really funny guy to be around.
He's 7:15 at night, my makeup's running, and they're all still filming out there, and I'm really tired. I'm just pleased that I've finished, so I'm going to have.
Now we've got something really, really, really brilliant. We've got a group that's had 16 fantastically high top 10 hits. It's Spandau Ballet.
Through the Barricades, the song, was there any impression, or that might be like the album title?
To me, when I went through all the demos, Gary, it was the killer song. It was like, okay, well, back then albums had to have the single, the killer song, and unless you had that, then it wasn't deemed that you had a successful album.
It was different to anything we'd done on the previous albums.
Yeah.
You know, you obviously wrote it with Kidzo, Thomas Riley, in mind. Poor guy, shot during the Troubles.
His brother Jim, who was the drummer in Stiff Little Fingers, took me for a walk down the Falls Road to
to Kidzo's grave. And, you know, I could see the barricades between the Protestant Catholic side, and it was fairly shocking for a guy like me to see this, you know. And I think that just sort of, you know, went around in my brain for a while, and then when we were in Dublin, through the barricades, came out. We made our love on waste land.
Through the Barricades, the song I think is best piece of work, actually, much more so than True or Gold. Really special songs. I never ever, it's the one song I never get bored of singing. You know, that is, it's a bit special. We feel the same.
You probably heard it first, didn't you? You don't remember?
I do remember you playing it, yeah. Playing it to me and me thinking, yeah, that's a good tune.
Where do the drums come in? They don't come in for 2 minutes.
That's why I've always loved Through the Barricades, because, you know, over the years, it gives me 5 minutes off. Well, yeah. You know, the acoustic guitar going on.
I thought it was a really hard song to give away, you know, because there was a, the way I'd phrased it was personal to the way I'd written it, and unlike other songs where it's always Tony in my mind.
You know, I think it's a band really at the height of, you know, their skills. You know, for me, Barricades is still one of the best things we ever did. And now I know what they're saying as the drums begin to fade. We made our love on wasteland to the band.
When we came to take this out on the road, it was fairly easy for us, wasn't it? Because everything we'd already routined, we could play it all together as a band, couldn't we? Yeah. It wasn't trying to work out how to play this stuff.
No, we knew that, and we had it down pat.
Well, we always did.
It was easy.
I mean, first of all, I remember going back to Belfast and playing it at the King's Hall.
Yeah, and we were quite slightly nervous because
you must have been quite nervous.
It could be an arrogant sort of thing from our point of view. How dare they, to sum it all up?
Were they aware of what that song was written about?
Yeah, I think we'd spoken about it.
Some weren't, but, you know.
A terrible beauty, you know, is in there, that phrase. But I do remember one guy being on his mate's shoulders and he was crying and he was singing every word. And it was just a great, great reaction. I felt that they felt it was a song written about their city and that they were very excited and very proud of that. What they sing in the music of the brain. We made our love on
wasteland. It's like a Romeo and Juliet situation. It's a love story where the individuals come from either different races or different religions, and just the problems that would occur in that situation. So it's quite sad in a way, because that thing is happening all over the world. Not just in places like Northern Ireland or South Africa, say, but in London, with a black and white relationship.
Does this signify Spandau becoming more socially aware?
No, I just think it's not. You know, you write love songs. That's very easy, but you've got to put that in a situation that's a bit more unusual to make it poignant. And it's a song where the lyrics came first, as opposed to the melody. It wasn't a riff song. And the melody was just designed to enhance the words. And when we come to arrange it, it was a very difficult song to arrange because we couldn't... The more instruments we put on the beginning, the more it detracted from Tony's singing. So in the end, we just said, well, let's be brave enough to make it as simple as just an old-fashioned acoustic guitar and a voice.
For me, press junkets weren't really that exciting. I used to know, even if I said something, that'd be cut out. And they'd just keep Gary's bit. So this part for me was kind of like work. It was the bit in between of recording the album, where you get a lot of fun, to waiting to go out on tour. And it was the bit I always found the hardest. Yeah.
Right, let's have some questions from, the gang over here.
Lily, you've got a question.
What country do you like best?
England, I suppose, because, you know, it's where we come from.
Because we have the best cricket team in the world.
Oh, no, oh, no. I'm sorry, boy. <boys. laughs>
Now, we spend an awful lot of time away from England. And when we come back, because we all live here and parents are here and family, and it's lovely to come back. And it's nowhere like home. When you're coming back on the aeroplane and you see you coming in.
White Cliffs of Dover, Mark.
You see the White Cliffs of Dover.
You don't see the White Cliffs of Dover at Heathrow.
It's lovely.
No.
It's lovely. It's great coming back.
These are great memories because we used to love rehearsals. It's the first time, you know, you've recorded the album, you've put that to bed, you've done your promotion for it, and then you're going to take it out on tour and show it to people live. When Gary first shows you the songs, and rehearsing the songs is quite stressful, trying to work out those parts. But rehearsing to take a show out on tour, that's the best bit. What these songs mean to people, and you know exactly all those people that have come into the auditorium and bought their tickets and been waiting weeks to come and see you. You know that what this song and a few of the others are the songs that they bought those tickets to see, and you know when you're playing this and when you're rehearsing it of how you're going to make those people feel and how happy they're going to be when they hear it and what these songs mean to everybody, and so there's something that's happening in our heads here that you're expecting the crowd to go wild in this song. And that's exactly what happens. Always felt that the best thing Spandau Ballet did was playing live.
Back on it, that was our best tour ever. That's Spandau in their pomp, isn't it?
I agree.
And in a way, in every tour we've ever done since, you know, and coming back together again, doing those tours, it's the one we refer to. I mean, when we went in and when we got back together again in 2009, we put up a big screen in the rehearsal room and played the Through the Barricades live tour film for us to reference.
There's only one way to satisfy this feeling that's love.
This was the biggest tour that we'd ever done. I mean, this was a big tour for any band. This was us at our biggest. And in some ways, what I remember about this part of us on tour here is that this might have been the point where our egos left the planet for a short while. But when I look back at this, you know, and I think, thank God they did, because that's an experience that I'm glad I had. I mean, we were really close. close as a band. As we were touring around Europe and around the world on this particular tour, we were really close. But we had no reason not to be. You know, we were five mates from out of Islington that were conquering the world. And so why shouldn't you be close?
Gone full-blown screaming 13, 14-year-olds, and that's great fun. I mean, it's a great laugh. It's, you know, getting chased down the street. I mean, we thought we were in A Hard Day's Night, you know, which is one of my favourite all-time films. And, you know, I remember the Beatles there, and I thought, wow, this is like being one of the Beatles.
This is Tony Filmi.
And then it just went mad. In Australia, it was mad. In Europe, it went teeny. In Italy, they were fanatical.
You've been on tour for some time now. Are you still enjoying it?
Yeah, I think tonight will be about a 26th or 27th gig. So we've done about 4 weeks in Italy and Spain.
This is quite hard for me to watch. I loved Paula. She was one of the world's most beautiful women, and she was the most charismatic woman I ever met. And she was a really good friend.
It's good fun, isn't it? That's what you always wanted when you was a little kid and you dreamed of being a rock star. And there it is.
You see how Paula's teasing the whole band here, right? This is what Paula did to everyone. And everybody that you knew, right, that knew Paula, fell in love with her. I mean, if you look at what she's doing, you know, her eye contact with Tony, she's teasing him a little bit, she's so sexually aware of what she's doing, you know, of her power here, and she's just leading everybody on.
Why do you think it is that Spandau is so massive in places like Italy?
It's really small out there.
Look at me, I'm practically embarrassed talking to her.
No, we work very hard as a band, and whatever we achieve anywhere is because of hard work.
For us, it's the best part about being in a band, is going on tour. It's a good laugh. It's a great play to, well, it's empty at the moment, but it'll be full tonight. Well.
I mean, at the end of the day, we prefer it to anything else we do because it's the most real thing. You're all playing together, and you've got that spontaneity, and you've got the audience there, and you're face-to-face with the people who buy the records.
On this tour, we were kind of playing the part of rock stars more than we'd ever done before, because we were playing to so many people in so many arenas around the world. This is the period that I love looking back to. I love remembering this stuff.
Through the Barricades tour, we did Casa de Campo.
Casa de Campo, in our own right, over 100,000 people, which is quite cool. People to the horizon, seem to remember.
And we did a cover version that night, didn't we?
We did, yeah. Found it on the tape, didn't even know we had it. All Young Dudes, which is the only time we ever did it. Is that right?
Yeah, the only time we ever did it. The only time we ever did a cover version at all.
After the early period.
Until we did the Lou Reed tribute in 2010.
Austin, Texas.
Yeah.
So, was that the only time we played that song? The Motley Hoople song?
Yes. I can't believe that it was. And we've got a recording of it.
We're going to do a song now that was originally done by Motley Hoople back in the 70s. This is called All the Young Dudes. You know what I'm talking about.
Rock.
we're doing a vinyl, and we're going to be, which is a standard vinyl, but this is properly remastered from the original tapes, isn't it?
Yes, we haven't gone back to the production masters. We have gone back and we spent a lot of time yesterday morning verifying that we did have the original stereo mixes.
Yeah. I mean, you're saying that. Let's not forget that to get the tapes in the first place wasn't so tough, but to get the medium of playing those tapes was a nightmare because the machines don't exist anymore.
Well, they do, but none of them work.
Yeah. Oh, OK.
They're just museum pieces.
Why did we record it on Betamax?
No, it was on a Mitsubishi
850.
And there's one machine in America. We had to send the tapes to America to be transferred onto a hard drive. And then so when we've got all these tracks, and what we've been doing is having to re-put them into the order that they were on the original album with various crossfades as well.
We've copied all the crossfades, we've copied all the timing spaces between the songs.
And without a doubt, and having A-B'd it, given that there's some nice modern technology now, I think it sounds a lot better than the original CD and original vinyl.
Sometimes I have it up and I forget to put it down and I run over to Peter and I say, I can't hear anything on my guitar. Turn your volume pedal down.
Good letter. Very nice. She likes us. Someone likes us.
Vince, the tune's free shots, everyone.
What's really funny is when I see this now, it's almost like I'm looking at somebody else. You know, it's a different person. It's like when a Spandau record comes on the radio. I think I enjoy it in the same way as everybody else enjoys it, and not with a particular memory of recording it or taking it on tour, but just that was a time of the 80s.
It's an amazing thing, it really is, to go from this, well, a bunch of ordinary kids playing in a school music room to being on television and being on the radio. That was another world. People from where we came from didn't go on television. That was a magical world that you didn't sort of enter. And So, you know, our parents and everybody, you know, from the area we came from, everyone was very, very proud of us and that we'd achieved something. And we said we were going to do it, and we did it.
Look at the size of John's drum kit there. Look at the size of that. That show, it was funny, actually, because John's drum kit represented how big the band got. The bigger we got, the bigger John's drums got. Five guys that were best friends, and we loved each other dearly. And at that point in our lives, we would have died for each other quite happily. And I think that's how we got through it. Because when you think of how long Spandau lasted, it was much longer than most bands have success. You know, bands are together, but to get success that lasts that long, it is pretty unusual.
Everybody, it's been absolutely fantastic. We'll see you soon. Thank you.